Okay, next up we have our final speaker for today, William Lidwell from Stuff Creators Design. Like I said earlier in the day, his book Universal Principles of Design is something that we have at our house, and it's something that we keep coming back to over and over and over again for inspiration and guidance, and I'm really looking forward to William's talk today, so welcome.
Thank you. Thanks.
Hello. So the holdouts, these are the hardcore group, 4 o'clockers, huh? So my goal today in 60 minutes is to make you a better designer, right? And not like some undefinable spiritual mushy way, right? But you're gonna leave with like stuff you can go back to your office and apply and frustrate your colleagues with. Right? That is my commitment. But in order for me to be able to do this, I'm going to have to talk fast. I'm going to have to probably tell you some things you don't want to hear. And we're going to have to draw from outside your design area, from outside of outdoor design. Right? So we all up for that? We good for that? Energy? 4 o'clock energy?
Yeah.
All right. Very good. So the way we're going to do this is we're going to learn how great designers think. And the problem, of course, when we say how do great designers think and how can we model that, is we have a hard time even coming to terms with what great design is, right? So if we can't figure out what great design is, how can we decide who the great designers are? So that's our first challenge, right? We got to figure out how to do that. And then the second challenge is I need to be able to persuade you that I'm just not making it up, that it's just not my opinion, that there is something authoritative about the things that I'm going to be presenting to you, right? So, the first thing we're going to do, right, is look at some great designers. Now, I can't define great design, so this is my cheat for this method, right? Rather than defining it, I'm going to try to draw from great designers in history that, by and large, we can all agree are great designers, right? So in this case, product designers, Charles Eames, Raymond Loewy, Dieter Rams, for the most part, right? Designers like that, people look at that and they say, eh, maybe not my cup of tea, but they're great. Architect, Zaha, Edith, Frank Lloyd Wright, and Mies van der Rohe, right? Pretty unobjectionable, right? Keep going. Graphic designers, Saul Bass, Paul Rand, Massimo Vignelli, right? So you may not know all of these names, but these are all greats within their respective traditions, right? Some alive, some no longer with us. Innovators like James Dyson, Thomas Edison, Edmund Land, right? Edmund Land with the Polaroid camera. Entrepreneurs, Coco Chanel, Walt Disney, Steve Jobs. And engineers like William Hewlett-Packard, Kelly Johnson, SR-71, like Skunk Works, Lockheed, right? And Edwin Armstrong, the inventor of the FM radio. So what I've done is compiled the list from all the different design disciplines, all the different design specializations of great designers, right? 277 in all. We're not gonna go through them all today, right? But a big list. And the idea is, any person in this room, you might look at this list and say, I don't think that person's a very good designer. Or I don't like Frank Gehry, for example, is the one I always hear about. Frank Gehry is not a great architect, right? Well, individual people on this list you may contend with, but the idea that by and large out of that many, right, most of them will be great, right? We can agree that most of them are great, and then the average of all of them will take care of that variance, will take care of the things that we might disagree on, okay? All right, step two, and the harder part, is then I proceed to go and look at everything that all of those people have ever written, have ever said, or that was ever written about them. And any time there was any specific technique mentioned that they used, right, a heuristic, a method that they talked to others about, I noted it, I listed it, just like you see there, right? So you go through all of these different designers and you list all of these techniques, and we end up with two lists, right? A list of all these great designers, and a list, a comprehensive list, of all the different kinds of techniques, heuristics, that they apply to do their craft. So the question is, when I create a matrix and I put all the heuristics up top and I put all the designers on the left and I cross-reference them with one another. So in other words, I go and I say, I have, you know, Raymond Loewy. And I say, okay, he does that one and that heuristic and that heuristic and that heuristic, right? And I proceed down the list. And in my flow, in my spreadsheet, every time there's a hit, I put a one in there. So just the number one, right? What that allows me to do is then at the very bottom, I just sum all of my columns. And that gives me a frequency histogram. So here's the big question after all of that work, what's the histogram going to look like? If it looks like that, then I just wasted a few years and a lot of research, right? Because that would tell me that it's kind of a random distribution, right? That there really aren't a small set of heuristics or techniques that most of these great designers are using. Okay, I'm happy to report it looks something like that, right? So there are clear clusters, right? There are outliers, right, where there's only one or two, but there does seem to be clusters where a considerable number of these great designers use common heuristics, right? Use them a lot. And so the question is, are the differences statistically different, right? And so you do a simple test and you identify the ones that are statistically significant, and then that gives me a short list where I say, okay, those heuristics correlate very highly with the greatest designers that have ever lived, and some of which are still living, right? So my premise is that if we know what those are and we model them as designers, right, we for sure could do worse, right? I mean, that is going to align us with the best that there is, right? And so I think the way to make you a better designer, right, and to position you and your colleagues on a path to greatness is to model these heuristics. And so what are the heuristics? Okay, so just a real quick thing on what a heuristic is and why I think I have a shot at actually converting some things in 60 minutes, right? I heard Malcolm Gladwell mentioned earlier, right? So many of you may have heard somewhere along the line the idea that it takes 10,000 hours to acquire a certain set of skills, right? If you want to master a skill, 10,000 hours. Well, the 10,000 hours turns out not to be true, but it is an obscene amount of what's called deliberative practice. So it's thousands of hours. Maybe not 10,000, right? But a lot, okay? So skills are hard. If I were to come here today and say, you need to go master drawing, right? Or sewing, or some of the crafts, some of the skills, takes years, years and years and years. If I say, you just got to go memorize a bunch of facts, there's a bunch of new things you need to know, well, that's a lot of work, and then how do you apply that? Okay, heuristics is a third category of knowledge called metacognitive knowledge, strategic knowledge. And the cool thing about a heuristic is once you learn it, if you internalize it and you apply it, it gives you a new strategy on how you approach problem solving. And so the analogy I often give is, let's say every day when you drive to work, it's 3 miles. You take the same route every day and you go 3 miles. And then your neighbor comes up and says, why are you going that way? Well, 3 miles. If you take that left on Main Street, you can do it in half a mile. Whoa, right? I mean, so just like that, if you adopt that new strategy, you get this huge gain in productivity, right? That is kind of like what a heuristic is. It is a different strategy, a different way of approaching problem solving that if you adopt it, right, can give you that kind of overnight success. Now, that assumes you don't drink too much at the happy hour today and forget everything we talk about, but that aside, we have a shot. So one of the highest scoring heuristics is this idea of elegant simplicity over conspicuous featurism. Now, I heard some things earlier today about the frustrations about featurism, adding lots of products, and how do you have an elegant design, things like that. There was a great Dilbert cartoon that was out just a few days ago, and I really wanted to use it in this presentation, but I couldn't get permission in time. But Dilbert's sitting with a product manager, and the product manager hands him a requirements document, and Dilbert says, there are 400 features in this requirement document. You realize no user could possibly ever like handle a product of that complexity, and the product manager replies, yeah, you're right, we need to add one that says make it easy to use, right? So you add to the list, right? It's easy to featureize. It's always easy to add and add and add. And it is, in many organizations, right, kind of the marketing default. We want to show the value of our products. We want to get them out there. We want people to realize it. It is counter to many organizations and many marketing cultures to move towards simplicity, right? With each iteration, with each generation, to pull that back. It's a hard thing to do, but it is, I think, one of the earmarks of great design. So this guy here is Raymond Loewy. He is the father of industrial design. He is one of the earliest folks to actually acknowledge the idea that simplicity seems to play a major role in aesthetics. He started off as a functionalist, but after working on this problem for a while, he said, you know, actually, functionalism is important, but in terms of the amount of impact on the aesthetics of a product, it really seems to be simplicity. And a thing that he developed that I think kind of weighs in on some of the discussion that we had in an earlier panel that I think is really interesting is his concept of simplicity, of minimalism, was relative, right? It wasn't, let's always go for the simplest possible thing we can go for. He realized that tastes evolve with time, right? And so he intuited this principle he called the Maya principle, the most advanced yet acceptable aesthetic, right? That's the principle. And so this is an example where he said, for these different periods of time, these were optimal aesthetics. They were as advanced aesthetically as they could be, so as not to be normal looking, right? To stretch norms just a little bit, but not so far out there that nobody knew what it was, right? Now, he did this with everything. Obviously, you can see there's a human figure over there, chairs, phones, cars, trains. He did it with all kinds of things, right? Really, really powerful principle. And one of the interesting things to note, his concept of advanced, right, most advanced yet acceptable, his concept of advanced is what? It gets simpler and simpler and simpler. Each generation is becoming more and more simplified, right? Now, at that time, right, we're talking about early 1900s, at that time, this was an intuitive principle, right? There wasn't empirical evidence for that. But the work of Paul Eckert and some other guys out there have validated this, right? So they've actually gone out and they've taken a bunch of people and they've shown them a bunch of different product configurations and they put it on a continuum called typicality versus novelty, right? And they find that when things are too typical looking, when they're too average looking, people don't really care for them, right? As you move over and you get more and more toward novelty, just to the right of center, right? So a little further out, but not all the way, you find the sweet spot. That would be the most advanced yet acceptable, right? If you go all the way out and something's completely novel, it breaks everybody's brains, right? Nobody likes that. So it's finding this sweet spot on that continuum, right? Very, very powerful. Now, one of my favorite designers, right? And it kind of, again, goes to the question I think somebody asked, or the question was raised, why is it that in these award, you know, product design competitions, right? A lot of these products will win, but then they suck it up at the market, right? So you go out and you can't really commercialize them, a lot of the other things. Well, I think, in my mind, Dieter Rams is almost a great example of that because the Dieter Rams philosophy, right? He was the lead product designer for Brown. And you may recognize some of these products as the progenitors of the more familiar Apple products. That AM radio up there probably looks familiar to you. Even if you have never seen a Brown product before, it looks a lot like an iPod. And so it's important to note, he did not know about or did not observe Loewy's idea that this notion of simplicity is two-dimensional, right? This most advanced yet acceptable. Dieter Rams is like, yeah, screw that. It's the simplest thing possible. He jumped to the end, right? He really drove the envelope all the way down and said, I want the simplest form we can do. Well, one of the things that happened, right, product designers love it. Designers think he hangs the moon, but they sucked at the market, right? They were too advanced for that mass appeal. So he had a simple idea that designers love, and over the course of 50 or 60 years, mass markets have come to now appreciate that kind of simplicity. But at the time of their introduction, they were way ahead of their time. A similar thing is Coco Chanel, right? Everybody is probably familiar with the little black dress, and her attitude was very parallel to Dieter Rams. It wasn't, you know, hey, let's design for the time. Her thing was, no. You know, we're going to design it to have style, and we're going to forget fashion, right? And her concept of style was simplicity. She liked black and white, right? People don't like black and white. They don't get it. That was the attitude. They're not sophisticated enough yet. Very similar to Dita Rams. Now, that took a long time to take off, right? So that became successful, unlike the Dita Rams product. But a group that I think a modern example of someone who has kind of threaded the needle, right, is of course Apple, right? And the way Apple has done it is they've taken the Dita Rams approach with one exception, right? Apple realized that if we go outside this Maya continuum, this most advanced yet acceptable continuum, the problem is we're going to shock everybody, right? And they're not going to know what to do with it. So your options are you confine yourself to that window, right? Or you invest in the marketing and in the education to bring everybody along. That's what Apple does. That's how they have pulled that off, right? They've done the Dita Rams, but they've thrown so much money and so much education at it, and now they've developed the momentum where they've trained the market basically how to do this thing, right? I think it is fascinating. You want to see like the best example of the principle of Occam's razor ever, right? Like, how do you keep cutting away the essential? How do you move towards simplicity? That's it. You start with 2000. Every 2 to 3 years, you can see chipping away. How do we make it less? And to make Dita Rams happy, right? Dita Rams' thing was less and better, right? I don't want to give up functionality or power. So with every generation, they have reduced the footprint, they have reduced the materials and increased capacity, increased power and all the rest, right? So that is the way they've done it. That principle is sometimes called, right, progressive reduction. And I like that term, right? So I offer it to you for your consideration. I like that term because when you say reduction, the implication is it's negative, right? You're taking it down in some way. But when you say progressive reduction, I think it correctly captures it. You are improving something, you are advancing it by reducing it. And more explicitly, you see progressive reduction a lot of times with logos, right? So over long periods of time, and it kind of follows that Maya concept. As people become more familiar with brands, they need less information to have the brand awareness. And so you see this progressive reduction model apply to all kinds of brands everywhere, right? So one heuristic that we can apply is this idea of elegant simplicity, right? The nemesis is conspicuous featureism. So when you're designing your products and you're having the conversation, which no doubt everybody here has had and will continue to have, and they say, no, I think I heard the logo's gotta be bigger, right? I mean, all of the things, we gotta be louder, we gotta show more value. The counterpunch to that, right? The counter argument is, you know, that's not how the greats have done it, right? That we can do that, we can jump off that ledge anytime we want, but that doesn't align to greatness. That is not one of the great heuristics. Now you're armed with that to do that. Okay, second heuristic, right? Great designers are into this idea of what I call inside-out craftsmanship, right? Over bait-and-switch craftsmanship. Now I know that's a fairly loaded comparison there, but the idea here, right, is craftsmanship matters. Right? It really, really matters. It doesn't stop on the drawing board, right? So the great designers are fanatical about the execution and the final delivery, right, and everything about it. And again, I'm not just a total Apple fanboy here, but you can't help but marvel, right, that when you open up a computer case, this is the new, you know, Apple Tower, right, the new Mac Pro, that the layout and the organization of the electronics is just gorgeous, right? I mean, it's just gorgeous, and it's no coincidence. One of the things that Steve Jobs talked about is if you have a great carpenter and they're making you a chest of drawers, right, they don't put plywood on the back. Now, think about that. That's a really kind of profound thing, right? Because if you look at most of the furniture in my house, right, and I'm not gonna name like IKEA-like names, but, you know, the backs are the fiberboard, the lesser products, because it's kind of out of sight, right? Well, that tells you something about the craftsmanship. Now, of course, the benefit is it's cost, right? I mean, it lowers the cost. but it also lowers the perception of quality. Now, one of the places you see this, and it makes me crazy, I'm from Houston, and I'm not just saying that because we won a basketball game last night, but in Houston, there is a ton of housing development going on, right? And this is what most of them look like. Most of them are actually getting narrower and taller, right, the classic McMansions. But this is the part that makes me insane, right? So that's not great, but that doesn't make me insane. This makes me insane, right? Okay, that really makes me insane. So that's the bait and switch, right? I mean, that's total bait and switch. It's like, oh, look at this nice brick house. Look at the quality. This thing's going to last forever. And then you walk around to the back, and you see hardy plank. Okay, so what else about this house is hidden away that I haven't seen that I can't trust? The plumbing, the electricity, the quality of the foundation, right? It calls all of that stuff into question, right? And so, that's one, I think, of the imperative things, looking at every little detail and thinking about, okay, if somebody did know about that, what would they think about me? What would they think about the design? And to show you how a heuristic can transform behavior like that. So this is my proof to you. This is a Craftsman for a table that I designed, right? And when I first designed it, and so this is after he and I just had a talk, and he's very upset, and so he's looking at this very intently, because this is like the ninth prototype that I vetoed, right? And you can see that's a very finished piece. It's been oiled, it's polished, I mean, this is it. And so the joints weren't right, right? They weren't right. When we talked about it at the beginning, we were like, the joints have to be fine to the touch. If I can run my finger over any joint, right, and I can feel a bump, it's not there, even if it looks right. And that's what he's doing there. He's calling bullshit on me, and he's like, dude, I'm looking down the thing, it's perfectly aligned, right? And I'm like, I can feel it, right? It's not there. Prior to this conversation, fascinating, right? This is a excellent craftsman, wood craftsman. Prior to this conversation, I'll show you the next one. This is actually the finished one, right, that turned out beautifully. This area in the middle is where letterpress type goes. It's a letterpress collage that sits down in that, right? And so once that letterpress collage is down in that table, the intent is it's there forever and ever and ever, right? Because it's like a bajillion pieces of letterpress, and it's lead and copper and wood, and no one's going to intentionally remove it, right? It's going to be there for a long time. So his attitude initially was, okay, nobody is ever going to see that. Let's use MDF, right? Let's use kind of a standard fiberboard. We can just do it. It's easy. And so rather than me just being the designer that said, no, I'm a pain in the ass, I want it my way, I explained this heuristic to him. I was like, look, this is what excellent craftsmanship is, right? Your name is going to be attached to this. People are going to own this table and hand it down to their kids, right? And there will come a day, right, when these things will reveal themselves. Your name, your legacy is attached to that. Now, do you want a half-assed piece of plywood on that thing? Or do you want to do it right? Do you want to do it and make it like this beautiful thing, right? And truly, 10 minutes of hearing me talk about it, it's like, all right. And it's completely flipped. Then I had the other problem where I couldn't get him to stop, right? I'm like, dude, it's good enough, right? I mean, it's perfect. And so I think it's part of the transformative thing, right? Once people get, you see how offensive like that three-sided house is, and it's even worse than that. There are many of them that are one-sided, right? They're just the brick veneer on the front. So if you even like do that, it's exposed. So anyway, so heuristic two, right? The craftsmanship, it's inside out, it's all the way through. It's not just the surface, it's not just the veneer. Now, I heard someone mention this earlier, and I was like, yes, whoever that person was, so I don't know who it was, but they were talking about failure and how designers, it's about risk-taking and you gotta be out there and all of that, and I was like, testify, right? I mean, that is dead on. And one thing that you see repeatedly, and it really is kind of a fascinating thing to see how the great designers talk about it. It really isn't about like this idea of not fearing failure. That's really kind of the wrong problem frame. Embracing failure even kind of understates it a little bit, right? So I was like trying to find this right word, so I just stole it from Milton Glaser, but it really is, failure is just part of the process, right? We attach things to it that make a spirit, right? But it's part of the process. As soon as you accept it's inevitable and it's going to happen again and again and again on any worthwhile endeavor, you accept it, you expect it, you don't fear it, right? You just accept that it's going to be there. And so one of the great examples of this, and it's kind of, you know, comical, there's all kinds of variations of the quote where, you know, a reporter comes in and they say, you know, Mr. Edison, right? How do you feel about your, you know, 1,000 failures of trying to find the right filament for the light bulb, right? And he got pissed, right? Because, I mean, he's been in his garage putting little filaments in this thing. And so he says, I didn't fail. I didn't have any failure. I found, depending on the numbers you want to believe from the quotes, either 1,000 or 10,000 things that won't work, right? He does not see it as a failure. He sees it as a step in the journey to finding the solution. Right? That's a big part of this. James Dyson, right, if you've ever heard him talk or do an interview, he says it every time, right? I mean, just like religion, more than 5,000 prototypes it took me to get the Dyson vacuum cleaner. 15 years, 5,200 and something prototypes, right? An insane number of prototypes. And so a reporter asked him, they're like, well, didn't you get frustrated? I mean, 15 years, 5,000 prototypes. Think about how many closets that would fill in your house, right? I mean, that's a lot of prototypes. And his answer was, you know, that you're looking at it wrong, right? You work on it till it's right. These are just, you know, and the metaphor he used I really liked. He's like, a failure is like a rung on a ladder, right? You've got to know where it is so you can put your foot on it and go to the next step. You can't transcend it until you know where the limits are. It tells you where the next step is. Now, that's a great metaphor, right? He really embraces it. And then this is the Milton Glaser graphic designer, right? The I Love New York guy. And he, you know, I really like kind of his thing. He talks about it as, you know, there's this tension between personal and professional development. In terms of personal development, failure is great. It helps you discover yourself, hardens you up, you learn from it, right? But professionally, it's an impediment, right? If you fail a lot at work, that's a problem. How do you resolve that tension? His solution, which I think is a profound solution, right, is you embrace it, right? You own it. It's not lip service. You don't say, oh, yeah, you know. You try to create a culture. If you're in a design culture, right, the design culture should be tolerant of risk-taking and of failure, and they should see it the same way all of these other guys see it. And part of the ammo for you to affect that change in the culture is this heuristic, right? Okay, do you want to be like the greatest designers who ever lived? Or do you want to be like all these other people, right? The mediocre, the lesser designers, right? I mean, that's the cultural change that you have to bring, right? This guy's Paul McCready, mechanical engineer, winner of the Kramer Prize. Most interesting to me, right? So this guy is the... He has applied this embracing failure, institutionalized it. He started off, his challenge was, I want to create human-powered flight. I want to create an airplane, and I'm sure you've all seen it on TV at one point, but it was the Condor, right? So little guy cyclist in this little, you know, Mylar and tube thing, and he's pedaling like crazy, like a little gerbil, and then it takes off, and he flies, and he wins a Kramer Prize, right? Well, when he started that thing, he got into it, and after about 4 to 5 months, he realized, I'm solving the wrong problem, right? I thought I was here to try to solve the problem of human-powered flight. That isn't the problem. That's not why nobody has pulled this off yet, right? That's not the real reason. The real reason is, what everybody does is they spend a year theorizing and drawing up plans and creating these elaborate things. They go then find a fit athlete. They put them in a stadium. The guy pedals like crazy, and after, you know, 30 minutes or so, eventually something will happen, the whole thing will crash, it breaks up, and then they got to spend another year redoing it all. Okay, well, that's ridiculous, right? I mean, who's got that kind of time and money? He realized the real problem is we got to learn to fail fast. I accept we're doing something that's never been done before, right? It's never been done. We're going to fail. It's going to happen. So, what is the fastest way I can get all of these failures out of my way so we can move on to success? And they switched their focus to how do we rapid prototype these things so we can learn quick, That became the focus. They changed the materials they used, they changed the approaches they used, and in 6 months, they had a working prototype. In a year, they won the prize, right? So embracing failure, failing fast, helping spread that word, heuristic number three. Okay. Now, from Texas, I can tell you, if it ain't broke, don't fix it. That's a very common heuristic in Texas, right? So, never leave well enough alone. It's back to Raymond Loewy. That is the name of his book. That's the title of his book, right? So, the father of industrial design, and that's why I'm actually going to go ahead and show this lovely little graph again. Because the idea of Loewy, right, is that tastes, aesthetic preferences, all of these things are constantly evolving. The world is turning. Things are constantly moving. Your design has to constantly move with it. He did not accept nor acknowledge this idea of a timeless design. Now, that's a very popular notion in a lot of circles. He didn't accept it, right? You are constantly changing and improving and tweaking. If not because you're fixing the things that you know about that you want to fix and update and all of that, the world's moving. Things are changing, right? So you start off at the outset, I'm not only going to remediate the weaknesses of my products and the designs, I'm going to improve their strong parts. I'm going to constantly kind of upgrade and constantly improve. And that's what you see there. You see that in certain products, right? Now, in some cases, I think you could debate whether they're always going in the right direction, right? But they are investing. When you certainly look in the kind of early stages when they evolve from more of a milk bottle to the curvy bottle, even though the route of getting there was a little windy and unintentional, right? They ended up with a form factor for that bottle that stuck out on the shelves. It was unique, it was interesting, that has a lot of interesting kind of anthropomorphic things going on, and constantly reinventing that. I mean, if you think about it, you're selling sugar water. Right? Once you take cocaine out, there's just not a lot left you can do, right? It's about marketing. And so how do you kind of draw the eye in? How do you put that stuff in there? That's how you do it, right? You constantly are reinventing, constantly trying to say, what is the expression of the masses? Where are they in that most advanced yet acceptable continuum? And you try to identify that. I'm going to pick on this a little bit more, right? I'm going to zoom in on these three because for me, this defines it, right? Never leave well enough alone. So your Apple, you're about to go down, you're ridiculed, right? You bring back Steve Jobs, but nobody really has any prospects that you're going to do anything, right? You come out with a new iMac, and you turn it all around. I mean, it literally turns it all around for Apple, right? They now have a shot of becoming something. And in two years, you switch. Now think about, I'm still learning all of the outdoor, you know, so like I had to look up the Denali. I mean, everybody was cursing the Denali. So I didn't know what it was, right? But I mean, imagine, right? 2 years and you cannibalize your own product line. That's serious, right? That the idea of, you know, we're gonna keep moving ahead. We're not gonna wait till we're forced to change. Right? We're going to change on our own terms. 2 years later, they change it again, right? And adopt the design language of the iPod, right? That's an amazing kind of proactive, never leave well enough alone mindset. It's very atypical. Now, this old fella, most of you probably don't know, his name is Ed Deming. For those of you who've like maybe sat in circles and passed little marbles around in little quality circles and you were subjected to that, I'm sorry for that, but there's a good part to this, right? He is the father of total quality management, right? Which by itself isn't so cool. The cool part, though, is he realized that the pathway to manufacturing excellence, kind of back to craftsmanship and back to excellence, right? Continuous improvement. And so when he went to Japan, when Japan, from a manufacturing point of view, was the laughing stock of the world, right? They were not competitive in the United States. Deming could not get his phone calls returned in the United States, right? So when he would go out and try to consult, people wouldn't pay attention. The Japanese listened to him. They adopted TQM. They adopted theories of management. And they cleaned our clocks for 15, 20 years, right? This idea of continuous improvement on the line, anybody on the line, if they have a problem, they say, hey, I think we could improve this if we did this little thing here. Or if I had a tool that would do that, boom. You get a gaggle of designers off going and they're milling out a tool somewhere, right? And they come back, process improved. Fast, continuous, never ending, right? So, I mean, from a management point of view, from a product design point of view, a strategy point of view, it is a super powerful thing. In the literature, sometimes that's called constructive discontent, right? The idea of you're being constructive about it, but you're just not happy with anything, right? And a funny story on that, a colleague of mine, right? And this is a little bit of too much information, I realize, so I'll spare you the details, but we're in a bathroom. Just leave with that. And so we're washing our hands, right? And we're drying it on the towel. And he makes the following observation, just cracked me up. He says, you know, I've noticed that every time you dry your hands on these towels, only the middle part gets wet. They should save millions of dollars a year and just cut off the corners. Everybody should have round towels. Okay, now there's manufacturing reasons why that may not be the greatest suggestion in the world, right? But there's a logic to it, right? That is constructive discontent. He is constantly like, hey, wouldn't it be better if we could, you know, he's constantly looking for those opportunities. And I just thought it was a great example. It was hilarious, but perfect example. Okay. I heard some discussion around this earlier. Excellent. So I thought it was a great prelude. This idea of reframing problems versus accepting problems as they're delivered. So common example, right? Somebody comes to you and they say, I need a design for X. And here are the constraints, right? It needs to do this, this, this. You get some kind of design brief or some variation of that. And so I'm going to give you a real example that I'm totally cribbing from a guy named Theodore Levitt, but, you know, I'm citing him, so it's okay. So imagine you work for a tool company, right? You make tools, specifically like hand drills and things like that. And I come to you and I say, we're losing market share on drill bits, right? We used to sell this many and now we're selling this many. And I need you to figure out a new kind of drill bit that we can sell so we can be competitive again, right? So that's kind of your general charge. And so you're like, well, okay. And so you go to Home Depot, maybe you look at all the different kinds of drill bits out there, but you know, a drill bit's kind of a drill bit. So you can kind of color it gold, right? And kind of put some weird carbide diamond thing on it, right? Put it in fancy packaging maybe, give it some cool new name. So you're thinking about all of these things, right? That is accepting the problem as it's defined, right? Levitt makes the point that you need to kind of abstract that out and say, okay, do people really want drill bits? No, they want holes, right? They want holes, they don't want drill bits. Nobody wants a drill bit. Everybody wants holes, okay? So that's a big difference, right? Because there's lots of different ways to make holes that may have nothing to do with drill bits, okay? But you can keep playing this game, right? Maybe you do a little research on that and you go, well, do people really want holes? Or maybe they want to like hang pictures, right? Because if you say, wow, 80% of the people buying our drill bits are really buying them so they can drill a little thing and put a deal on the wall so they can hang a picture. So what they're really wanting is a solution to hang a picture. That's very different, right? The kinds of solutions that you can conceive to hang a picture could be wildly different than the constraints associated with redesigning a drill bit, right? And so reframing the problem at the outset, right, is something you see consistently among all these great designers. They do not accept the constraints. The first thing they do is abstract it out, right, and start asking these weird questions. Well, is that really what they want, right? And there's even a technique. It's called the five whys technique, right? You keep asking why, right? Why do people want drill bits, right? I mean, then you say, oh, well, they don't want drill bits, they want holes. Why do people want holes? Well, typically you ask that five times and you can get somewhere, right? Because they don't want those things at the beginning. We just think that they do. So some examples here, right? So we just don't have to always look at old people that I think are really excellent kind of modern examples, things going on where I fell in love with the reframe, right? One is prostheses, right? So you lose a leg. You need a prosthetic device. Most prosthetic design and engineering is functional. It's a very functionalist discipline, right? Because it's hard to make something that fits on a stump that's going to be different every time, that's going to be comfortable, that's going to be reliable, that's going to provide the structure and all the rest. So that is where the focus of almost all of the energy has been. More of it's moving toward the engineering, the bionics and things like that. But some of you may have seen this new movement, right? And this is Bespoke Innovations, and they've reframed the problem away from, you know what, rather than having a prosthetic device that's trying to look natural, that people want to conceal, maybe we should try making something right? That doesn't even try to do that. It is an expression of that person's identity, something that they can show off. And in fact, you know what? They don't even call them prostheses. You ready for this? This is great. You know what they call them? Fairings. I mean, is that cool or what? I mean, a fairing, right? Like a motorcycle fairing, right? So now you're not going out and you're not getting a prosthetic device, right? You're getting a custom fitted, custom built fairing that expresses your identity, the kind of statement that you want to make, something that you want to show off, not conceal, something that doesn't even attempt to look natural, right? What a powerful thing. Here's another example of it, different person, right? I mean, how cool is that? One more, riding a motorcycle. I just think it's awesome, right? I invite everybody to go check out their website. I mean, they just have some fantastic stuff going on. Another good example that's newer, right? Just recently came out, but I think it demonstrates the example pretty well, right? In this idea of reframing. If you say, same kind of design brief kind of scenario, right? I come to you and I say, I need you to design me a new bike helmet. Well, so the same thing, right? So you start looking at materials and head shapes and all the other stuff, right? And you say, wow, there's a bajillion, you know, cycle helmets out there of every possible configuration, making something that's going to be competitive. What do we got to do? Lower price, blah, 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 right? You go into that whole thing. Well, if you reframe the problem and you say, okay, why do people need helmets? Right? Well, that's not really what they're trying to protect their head, right? It's not about wearing a helmet. It's about protecting your head. Well, when you simply reframe the problem like that, it opens up possibilities that weren't available to you before. And so this product called the Hubding, right, looks like a little scarf type thing you wear, right? You go around. Here's some kind of more styly looking things, right? So calling that a helmet, right? Now you may be wondering, well, that's great. What happens when you crash and all of that? And guess what? Boom! You got an airbag around your head. Now, of course, there's all kinds of sophisticated algorithms and electronics to make that work, because it would suck pretty bad if you're going down the street and that thing went off, right? So I am not saying that is the next great solution for bike helmets, but what it does demonstrate, right, is the power of reframing the problem. As soon as you get away from thinking it has to be this exoskeletal thing wrapped around my skull, it opens up possibilities that you may not have thought of before, okay? All right. Number six, and always a favorite, is this idea that the customer doesn't know what's right, okay? This is one of the highest scoring heuristics you see. Great designers do not believe that the customer knows what's right. They don't believe it, right? Now, to be fair to Marshall Field, who is the originator of this customer is always right, Marshall Field was a guy, right, who started the department store. It was surprising to me when I find these things out. But anyway, so... And I don't think he even really meant that, right? I think what he was really saying was always make it right for the customer, right? So if you have a bad interaction with the customer, make it right. You know, make them happy, give them money, whatever you got to do, just, you know, make them satisfied. But it has been kind of miscombobulated over time, and it is like permeated design schools and other places where it's like the customer is always right. Well, now we do surveys and focus groups, and we listen, and we ask questions, and we do all of the rest. Well, the great designers don't believe it, right? They don't believe they can tell you. And so let's just look at some examples. We'll talk a little bit more why. And so Henry Ford, right, Model T, right? And one of the things that he is attributed to have said or claimed to have said is people said, well, do you ever talk to your customers and ask what they want? And he was like, no, because they would just tell me they want a faster horse, right? The idea is they don't have a frame of reference. They don't know the possibilities. They operate within the frame that they have. And so since they don't know that, they can't give you forward-thinking input and ideas, right? They're constrained by that. Now, he also said, which is, I think, just one of the best lines ever, right? Someone said, well, does it come in different colors? And, you know, of course, yeah, you can have any color they want as long as it's black, right? So he was another big kind of like it's simple and all of that. Now, some of that was cost, right? Because he was cheap. And so part of that was black paint was cheap and he wanted to kind of keep it that way. But it was really this idea that I am creating this product, I am delivering it, and I know what's best. Now, maybe a better, more modern example for the youngsters in the audience, that funny looking square thing in his hand used to be what the iPod is to you, right? That is the Sony Walkman. And so one of the great kind of stories about how this whole thing happen. Akira Morita has a colleague, and his colleague loves to listen to his music. He has his own private music collection. But of course, we're talking about the 70s, right? Like way back. And so he's carrying around this giant, I mean, forget even the boom boxes, right? This is big by boom box standards. And the headphones back then were like that. I mean, they're more like giant earmuffs, right? And so he's carrying all this around, and Kim Marito's watching his poor colleague going, God, you know, there's gotta be a better way than this. Hey, why don't we make one portable? Okay, I know this seems so ridiculously obvious now. Okay, but this was the pushback. Are you ready for this? People do not want small portable devices that can't record. Who on earth would want just a player? Everybody wants a recorder, right? One. Two, everybody knows that the bigger the box, the better the sound. And plus, if it's lightweight, people won't think it has any value. It's gotta be heavy, right? That people pay for mass, right? They took him to the mat on that, right? He had to literally declare to his sales force and the customers that they polled, I will resign as CEO if this fails. He had to put his job on the line. He was so convinced. And he repeatedly said, kind of as a retrospective, this is the kind of product that is impossible to focus group. You cannot survey and say, hey, wait, would you use this? Is this a good value? It would fail every time. You can't do it. Another great example, this is Dean Kamen, inventor of the Segway. This particular device he's on is iBot. I got to interview Dean Kamen for Make Magazine a few years ago. And showman that he is, this is him in his stadium, reluctantly posing for a photograph, as you can see. And so one of the cool things about the iBot, right, which is this wheelchair, but it can go upright like a Segway and then balance on two wheels. And so like you can go up and push him, and I did. And you can go up and like push them on that, and it'll like self-stabilize. It's this really kind of extraordinary engineering accomplishment. But the thing I was most impressed with from a design point of view is this concept, right? This realization that when you are sitting in a wheelchair, you're always looking up at people. And they're always looking down at you. And when you look at the testimonials and the people I interviewed for the book, right? That's what they talk about. They don't talk about all of this other stuff and the stair climbing. They would say things like, I used to go to cocktail parties and I was constantly like bumping into people's legs and they were looking down, right? And I'm looking up and it was this, and now I don't do that anymore. Now I eye to eye, I have conversations with people, right? That's what they talk about. And so that to me is an extraordinary design insight, right? I mean, that unbelievable. And so I asked it. How did you come up with that extraordinary design insight, right? We want to know. Surely you went and talked to lots of people who ride around in wheelchairs, right? Maybe you surveyed them, maybe you videoed them or watched them or whatever. And Dean came and said, no. We don't waste time with any of that because when you do that, they tell you things like, I want bigger cup holders, right? Right? They are, again, restricted within their frame of understanding. It would never occur to them that you could have something like this that could, like, transformer style, you know, put wheel over wheel and kind of go up and raise the person. They don't even know that that's possible, so they could never recommend it. So, but what he did was made his engineers and designers ride around in wheelchairs, right? He condemned them to wheelchair riding for long periods of time. And as they're riding around, they're like, this really sucks, right? I mean, they're realizing, wow, this is a challenge. And then they are the ones that came up with the insight that, wow, we're always being looked down on, right? We need to do something about that. They did have the technical understanding of how to do that, right? So another example of the limits of thinking the customer's always right. This is another one of my favorite examples. This is Art Fry. Right, so you probably don't know Art Fry is Art Fry, but you know his sticky notes, right? This inventor of the sticky notes at 3M. Now here's the great story about that. He came up with the idea of sticky notes because paper scraps kept falling out of his hymnal, right? So he's like in church and he's like doing little bookmarks in his Bible and they keep falling out. And he's like, eh, you know, it's frustrated about that. So he happens to attend a seminar of another scientist at 3M who they were kind of, his project was on the cutting block. He developed kind of a poor glue, right? A low tack glue. Now, if you think about that, right? You're tasked to go develop a really good glue, but your glue's not very sticky. Eh, That's a problem, right? It's like, I have a glue, but it doesn't really stick very good, right? And so the question is there, you got a solution, is there a problem that it solves? So at 3M, right, they had this thing that they got to go around and kind of present their different, you know, findings to these different groups just on the off chance that it might synergize with someone else. Well, Art Fry was in the audience, and he was like, holy cow, that would keep the scraps of paper in my hymnal, right? That is exactly what I've been looking for. So they hook up, they end up making a sticky note, but here's the best part, right? So they originally do focus groups, and they sit everybody down and they say, what would you think if we gave you stacks of square paper, we can colorize them, right? That have little bits of glue on them that you can stick anywhere. You can use them as bookmarks, you can use them on pegboards, right? You can do anything you want with them. Universally, right, they said, that's stupid. Why would anybody do that? Why would I pay for that? I would just use a scrap of paper, right? So dejected, they go back and they're like, oh, you know. And they're like, we've got to try it again. So they advocated, right, lobbied internally. They got another shot, but this time they did like an actual focus group where they gave them samples, right? Yeah, this is stupid. Who would buy this stupid thing, right? Bunch of square paint, yeah, right? I'm not going to pay for that. Not until they just started giving out prodigious quantities of these things for free to people. Just said, here, go take these things and see what happens. Did they start getting calls back saying, hey, those things are really cool. You know, where can I get these things, right? And so the idea is you can't just go out and ask the question. You can't just go out and survey. It is the intersection of understanding between the customer need and the world of possibilities, right? It takes both. All right, analogical insights over analytical thinking. Now, this whole big data thing is a new thing, right? But the idea of collecting data and being data-driven is not so new. And so there's huge schools of thought out there that we got to be more analytical in our approaches. We got to follow all of these, you know, rigid structures. But if you look at most of the innovations from the great designers, almost all of them seem to come from analogies, right? They are analogical thinkers, and they're doing analogies all day long, right? They're insufferable because they're constantly analogizing when you're talking to them. Hey, that's kind of like this, and you're just like, right? And so the idea here is to embrace that kind of analogical thinking when you're problem solving, right? Rather than taking traditional analytical approaches, the idea is proactively analogize. And so just to give you some examples of how analogies have resulted in some interesting products, this is an image of a napkin, right, at a pizzeria where the patron was eating calamari. So what happens when you take Philip Stark and you put him in a place and you give him calamari and you let him sketch? Well, you get something that becomes the best-selling, right, juicer, maybe of all time, but certainly in modern history, right? Now, people argue the merits of that juicer, right? It's got all kinds of functional problems and whatever. And, you know, even Philip Stark himself, he says, I didn't really make it to, like, juice, you big dummy, right? It's a conversation beast to help people fall in love, right? That's, I mean, you know, he's French. And so that's his thing. But, right? Fascinating, eating calamari, right? What do great designers do? Oh, what's that look like? Hey, look at that little thing. That would be an interesting exit chute for juice. Hey, I'm working on a juicer. Bada bing, bada boom, you have juicy salif, right? Very fascinating. Frank Lloyd Wright, in this particular structure, he was commonly applying analogs to his different buildings, right? In this particular one, the Unitarian Meeting House, he became inspired by worshiping hands. Right? So he's going there, it's like, what's the structure? What's the feel of this place? And he sees everybody praying. He's like, that's the thing, right? That's the thing I want to bring to the structure. It sounds like everybody here probably knows more about this than I do, so I won't even bore you with my analysis of the Nike Shox, other than to say it's an obvious analog, right? It's something, and you know, to me, one of the interesting things, the decision could have been made to conceal that structure, right? You could have said, well, we're going to put it in the sole and not reveal that. But here the analogy, right, is brought out. They're like highlighting it. So this is like shocks like on a motorcycle or a car or whatever. And, you know, super successful. And then this is, again, a great like James Dyson, you know, analogy. He's Mr. Analogy, right? So James Dyson, every day he's driving to work and he goes by these big sawmills. And he's working on a vacuum cleaner, right? He's having trouble with his vacuum cleaner, but he's passing the sawmill. day after day after day after day. And there's this big kind of wedgy looking thing over at the sawmill, right? You know, you've seen them, they look like big cone type things, right? Well, it's a cyclonic separator, right? They use it to purify air, get the dust out of the air, right, and purify it. And so one day he's like, well, that's an interesting mechanism. I wonder if I could do something with that. Hey, guess what? I'm working on a vacuum cleaner. Maybe I can put these two things together. Bada bing, right? The Dyson vacuum. Again, kind of born of analogy. Woody Norris, inventor out of California. This thing he's holding here, it's a hypersonic speaker, right? It's fairly new technology. You may not have seen it. The way it works is this. So I'm actually taking the picture here, so he's aiming it at me. When he plays that, you can hear what he's playing, right? But here's the weird thing. If I'm like aiming it and I do that, people over there can't hear it anymore. People over here can't hear it. It aims it like a laser. Okay? People didn't think that was even possible with sound. So how did he do it, right? He knew a little bit about sound. But one day he was watching, I think it was a PBS show or something, on mixing colors and how you can get totally new colors by mixing different inks, right, that don't even look the same. And he was like, hey, wait a minute. You know, you can get totally different frequencies of sound when you mix different frequencies, right? You can get whole new frequencies you didn't start out with. Maybe mixing paint can be like mixing sound. That enabled him to use a carrier wave to create channeled sound, right? Really fascinating stuff. And he even says, when you ask him, I was like, you know, Woody, because he's prolific, he's got like a bajillion patents, how do you do this, right? And he's one of the few that's like this, oh, I invent by analogy. Like, you don't even, I walk around and just start analogizing things, right? And take my notebook, right? And start writing it down. And ever 30 or 40, I'm like, hey, that's a really great idea. And then he'll pursue it, right? All right, number seven. And I know I'm a little late, so I'll go speedy. So we talked a lot about this one. I heard some stuff yesterday from some of the other speakers about this. I thought was interesting. This eat your own dog food is a software idiom, right? Eat your own dog food means use your own product, right, in software. So in software, it's a big deal because if you create a really crappy product and you can use someone else's software to do your day-to-day job, it never gets fixed, right? One of the best ways to make sure stuff like that gets fixed is you make people use it. Now, not to be confused with, we're not going to let you use a competitor's product because they're a competitor. That's not eat your own dog food, right? Eat your own dog food means I'm using this for real in real context to see if it works, if it performs the way it's supposed to perform. And so this is my Portland pander, if you will, right? So obviously you have kind of the Tim Leatherman story where him and his wife are going around Europe, traveling, right? Cars breaking down, plumbing's leaking in their hotels, this terrible thing. So what's he do? He whips out his handy little pocket knife, which is terrible at doing all of that stuff, right? Because Swiss Army knife and the pocket knife was like a World War II thing, World War I trench officers. Okay, well that doesn't work, fixing your vehicle. And so it was that need, it was that real world situation where he was like, look, I need a thing that kind of like, you know, pliers, right? I mean, that's how he came up with the idea of pliers. He understood the problem at a deep personal level. For those of you who don't know Steve Gass and the Saw Stop, if you do any woodworking, you may have run across this before. It's an amazing demonstration you can see on YouTube. Basically what he does is that blade is tied to a mechanism. They electrocharge the blade with just a small amount of electricity. And if your finger comes into contact with it, or a hot dog or anything else that's wet, right, there's a discharge and it immediately stops the blade and recesses it. So the idea is, if you have that installed, right, no more cut off fingers. Well, how does someone come up with something like that? Well, guess what? He was a woodworker, and every time he was sliding the 2x4 by a table saw, he was like, yeah, right? You do that enough times, and he happens to be a physicist by training, right? So now he can go in and he can say, all right, I'm a physicist. I know about this whole momentum thing, angular momentum. I know about crumple zones in cars, right? Hey, why don't we create a mechanism that can kind of put all of that together? That's how he solved it. Again, I assume most of you are familiar with the kind of low alpine bag. My understanding, right, and it is my understanding, is that it's kind of a classic, right? To me, the most important thing about this, and it sounds unique really to your design niche, right? I think more people in your industry probably than any other specialization I've talked to live your work more than anyone else. You eat your dog food like a lot, right? And so, of course, they grew up, I mean that in a loving way, they grew up hiking and camping and climbing their entire lives, right? They did it their entire lives. So they have that deep, deep understanding of the problem that they can bring to bear on new solutions that you could just never get any other way. All right, speeding along here. All right, first principles, I'll go quick. First principles are like laws of nature, right? So the most basic kinds of laws that govern a problem. Fashion trends, I've learned now, I'm gonna start calling it trend, right? I've learned to refer to it in that way. But the idea of whatever the hot thing is of the day, right? The great designers always go to first principles. They specifically talk about, I ignore that stuff, I focus on this, right? And so just to give you a couple of quick examples, this is not a designer, this is a sea snake. And so the reason that's important here, right? You'll notice the banding. So the quick, short version evolutionary story behind this, right? Everything in nature can be seen by other things in nature, right? And so you either want to be camouflaged against your surroundings, so the things that can eat you can't see you, right? You have a chance. Or you want to broadcast your presence, right? You're alerting the world, basically, that I am poisonous, and if you eat me, you will probably die. And the natural selection kind of takes care of the rest. I'll spare you the details. Suffice to say that the sea snake does not get messed with by a lot of predators in the ocean, right? And so that high contrast banding, you see high contrast colors, black and white, yellow, black, things like that, throughout the animal kingdom, and snakes and plants and frogs, right? They alert to their toxicity. Now, there's another situation in nature where sometimes you'll have something like a sea snake that'll have that pattern, and everything's evolved to avoid that pattern. And then other lucky creatures who happen to also have that pattern just get the benefit. They're not really toxic, like this pilot fish, right? But they bear the stripes. They get the benefits. So they can swim along with a shark, and the shark's like, look, I don't want any part of it, right? So the shark's just going along, not messing with it, right? Now, there's another possibility. One is the alerting issue. The other one could be, and we now know, that sharks are colorblind. They only see in grayscale. So it may be that that black and white banding may act as kind of camouflage, like dazzle camouflage. We don't really know. Is it an alert signal or dazzle camouflage? Don't know, but this is the interesting part. On islands of Melanesia, right, these Melanesian men, there's this thing called a snake dance. When they go fishing, they do the snake dance, and before they go out fishing, they paint all of these white stripes and they darken themselves with coal. What a funny tradition. They think it prevents sharks from attacking them. They've developed that. Anthropologists in the region who go and study them have drawn the same conclusion. So when they get on their scuba suits, they're painting white across them. Well, of course, somewhere along the line, somebody said, surely there's a commercial application for this. Right? I mean, shark attacks are a problem, especially in Perth, Australia of late, right? That's a big problem. And so this is a shark attack mitigation system in, you know, done by kind of a some agency in Australia, and this is one of the things they're testing. But the idea is a first principle, right, of nature, like a law of nature, is this idea of mimicry. Let's look out in the world, let's find things that work, and then let's leverage them, right? We let that kind of guide the design. Another quick example. In Africa, big problem carrying water. Oftentimes, you know, they're carrying water 2 miles, right, to the village and back, right? So it could be a 4 mile round trip. The burden primarily falls on the women and children, right? I mean, it's a big, big problem when you're carrying water all day. And, you know, those, you're talking about how much can they carry? 35, 40 pounds tops, that's like 15 liters. You don't go through, I mean, you're making multiple trips in a day, right? I mean, it is not a good existence. So also, the nature of the bottles themselves, you can see they're difficult to hold, unwieldy, right? Can't really do much with them, right? Kind of problem. Enter the cue drum, right? The thing I love about this design, right, is it is so simple, right? It is so simple. By taking out, the logical thing you could have done is, let's just make a barrel. Let's make a big plastic barrel. The genius is taking out the axle, making a negative axle. Because now, you can draw a rope through it, you can pull it up the hill, right? There are actually pictures where people's wagons will break down and they strap on their cue drum, right? You gotta store food, you gotta carry fuel, you need to get across a body of water. It's good for everything. I mean, it is good for what ails you. This is like, I mean, awesome design, right? Excellent, just basic first principles of momentum, first principles of simplicity, leverage, I mean, just all kinds of greatness. And there are these guys going upstairs. Going up a hill right there. So last principle, right? So I know there's some discussion here talking around like how do you get you know, the stupid executives, you know, like market the product and get the sales done and, you know, all that stuff, right? So there's an answer to that, right? There is an answer. Guess what? These guys have the same problem. Everybody reports to somebody, right? And so they've had the same challenges. What you consistently find, the great designers are zealous missionaries and pitchmen. Zealous, like crazy. A lot of them started off not being comfortable in front of a crowd, not liking to talk, but they overcame it. They realized that this is a skill, this is a thing I gotta have. I have to be able to go make the case and pitch people and convince them that it's the way, right? It's this way, you gotta do it. Versus in different mercenaries, if someone's just doing it for the money, that comes across. I don't care how persuasive you are, if you're doing it for the paycheck, you don't really believe. I mean, experienced people pick up on that a mile away, right? So just a few quick examples. Nikola Tesla, right? Started off, right? Immigrant, didn't speak great English initially, was a little hesitant. He was a good orator, but a little hesitant. Became this crazy master showman, right? I mean, come on, right? Shooting electricity out of your fingertips, showing off wireless remote control boats. I mean, it was crazy. And he escalated that every time to people flocking to his presentation. So he went from this thing of, look, I can really do this, and trying to persuade them this will really work and blah, 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 to people lining up saying he can really do this, right? I mean, it's like a big deal. Walt Disney, master showman, right? I mean, if there's maybe the original experience designer, like Disney World, Disneyland, and Walt Disney being able to pitch and sell that thing. I mean, just master operator of the room. And then I will end with Edwin Land. So a lot of you may not know this guy, but before there was Steve Jobs with his distortion reality field or whatever, there was this guy, Polaroid, right? Jobs modeled himself on his presentations. He would take over the room. He would freak people out. I mean, they would be like, duh, you know, we'll throw money at him, right? I mean, just anything he wants. He had the ability to mobilize and make people believe in things that, you know, sure, you're going to hit a button, it's going to shoot out a piece of paper, and then magically a picture is going to appear on it. I mean, you think about how crazy that sounds, right? In 1970 technology, it really is an extraordinary thing. So, 10 heuristics, here they are. Right? My students always, no one take notes anymore. They always take out their camera phones and they just take it. So anyway, my representation to you, right, is if you internalize this, you do not drink them away tonight, right? You internalize these and apply them, it will make you a better designer. Statistically speaking, it is your best shot, right? There is more evidence supporting these principles and how they're going to impact your design than anything else in the field of design, believe me, I've looked, right? So I encourage you to do it. It will be your pathway to being a better designer. If you're already a good designer, I think it is your pathway to greatness. And the metaphor I've used is becoming Leonardo. So it's your pathway to becoming the next Leonardo. So thank you for your time.